Here we are in Grafton, North Dakota. It is July 25th, 2002. And we're about to have a little concert on the harmonica from Millard Hovey. When did you first start playing the harmonica, Dad?
About 80 years ago.
About 80 years ago. So what, you're about 8 years old?
Yeah.
So how much did harmonicas cost in those days?
About 10 cents.
And what did you pay for this one that you just bought in the spring of 2002?
$24.95.
So a little inflation, huh?
Yeah.
So what are you going to play for us this morning?
I don't know if I want to play any. I haven't played on for many years.
Well, you were just playing something. What was that first song?
That was Red Rain.
Well, let's hear a little rendition of that. It sounded very good.
It was great.
All right. So this harmonica brand, Marine Band, made by M. Honor. Is that the kind you had when you were young too?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's hear one more tune. What was that second one you were playing for us?
Oh, that was the same one as I played it.
I thought you had another one that you played earlier. Well, play whatever comes to your mind.
Start off, I just want to, can you shut it just a little bit so I can see it?
Okay, the second song you're going to play for us, what did you say the name of that is?
Tenting on the Old Campground.
And you said that's from the Civil War?
Yeah.
Where did you hear that when you were growing up?
I went to school for grade school.
Yeah, and that would have been in the 1920s then.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's hear that then. Talk about Pete.
Yeah, well, Pete was a pretty good violin player, and him and my dad, they used to play around some places and dances, you know. But they said he could start playing at 8 o'clock at night and play till 1 in the morning without playing the same tune twice.
And who was Pete?
My dad, he would have been my uncle, my dad's brother.
Okay. And where would he be playing?
Well, I suppose it's farmhouses around, or schoolhouses, or things like that. He may have just farmsteads, he's playing, he didn't like to play.
And didn't you say, haven't you told us that you used to play in some of the bands too?
Well, I used to be with George Elves and some, we played in some of the bands.
And what would you play?
I just chord the guitar.
Okay. This picture we're looking at, Dad, tell us about, you can pick it up now, or wait just a second, the camera's, I'm zooming in on it a little bit here. And who are we looking at here? What family is it?
That would be the Munson family picture.
And who are the
Munson?
That would be on your mother's side, right?
Yes.
Okay, you can pick it up if you want, and we'll just, why don't you talk about some of these people. Debbie, can you turn that light on?
Well, do you want me to point to
them? Well, yeah, point to some of them and what you remember of them, or...
I see. Now, here's Grandpa Munson. That was Munson Munson.
Yeah.
And that's...
Your grandpa.
Yeah, and Grandma Munson. That's Ronald was her name. Now, here are the boys. The boys are Martin, Olaus, Alfred, Edward, Oscar, and Gustav.
And obviously your uncles and...
Yeah, there were. And here's Ida, which is Ida Strand. Of course, that's Munson. Here's Emma, who was Mrs. Joel Fredham. Clara married Alvin Sandvik. He died, and that year later married Otto Hovey.
Who was Otto?
Otto was my uncle on my dad's side.
Okay.
And this is my mother, Magna Hovey.
Okay. And let's see. Why don't start up on the top again there? The guy up on the top left.
That was Martin.
Martin, what do you remember about Martin?
Well, he has pretty good language sometimes. And he didn't realize he was doing it.
Yeah. Do you remember any stories about that?
Well, he told me once a salesman had been over there and he was talking and he says, Jesus Christ, how that guy could swear. He said. And he didn't realize he was selling me the money. So I guess you forget.
Who's next to Martin?
Olaus. That's Morris's dad.
Morris Munson.
Morris and Glenn's dad.
Morris and Glenn.
And Alfred. They had no children. He married later.
Who is he?
Married to Annie Barstead. They lived up at Edmore at last. That's where Jeff Alban lives now.
Okay.
And he was mayor of Edmore for a couple of years.
And his name again was?
Alfred.
Alfred.
Edward, it's... He's the dad to Arnold Munson and Manuel Munson and Ida.
Okay, and who's next?
Oscar.
And Oscar and Martin lived together, didn't they, on the Munson place?
Oscar never married. He was at home there.
I remember when we have some papers in the files here, when Oscar died. He was fairly well off for the time, and he left good money to the library and the church and the hospital, and because the library said that was the largest gift they had received at that point. What I remember, Oscar used to drive pretty slow towards the end, but he always had a nice car too, didn't he?
Take it easy. Take it slow.
And we have a train lamp, I call it, that he used to have, and then an alarm clock that he gave me that we still have now in Las Vegas. And that. Who's next, Oscar?
Gustav.
Gustav, and yeah. Who did he?
Well, like Mandis and Willard.
And that's your mother right below him?
Yep. Yeah.
Her name again was Magna?
Yeah.
And middle name? If you remember?
I wouldn't say if it was Regina, or I'm not sure now. I don't
know. Your grandpa in that picture, point to him.
He was Munson. The original, his name was Hobo. But there were so many Hobos around here, so he changed his name to Munson. And he originally was a surveyor here before he married and settled down for the surveying through this country.
Do you remember the guy who came to Las Vegas when I was ordained? His name was Steve Ronshaugen. And my great-grandpa, in that picture there, I told Steve he looks like him.
Yeah.
And he said that he has some Munsons in his family.
Oh, could be.
So it's possible, but my great-grandpa, Munz then, looks a lot like Steve Ronshaugen.
Oh, yeah.
He looked like he's a tall man.
Well, he was, when he died, he wasn't old when he died, he was in his 70s. He had been digging potatoes that day. And
digging potatoes?
You know, went on a horse digger, you know.
Huh. All right, let's see. We kind of stopped with your mom. Next to your mom on the picture is your grandma, right?
Yeah.
And what was her name?
Runhild.
Runhild?
Yeah, Runhild.
What do you remember about her?
Well, she and her mother come down from Iowa. They come down separate on a wagon. So they each fell on a quarter of land out where they're living there.
So she kind of was a homesteader then.
In a way, yeah.
And her mom,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
What was her mom's name?
I'm not so sure. They said she smoked a pipe.
Your great-grandma, then. My great-great-grandma. She was a pipe smoker, huh? Tough lady if she was homesteading at that age. And they came up here from Iowa?
Yeah.
Do you remember your grandma?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Did she live to be quite old, or?
Pretty good age. She, Pearl took care of her at last, you know, right at home. She did that.
Who's next to her on the photo?
Clara.
Clara?
Yeah, that'd be Marvin Sandvik's mother, and then Emma.
Okay, and Emma again?
Right, Fred and Iowa.
Okay. Was it Emma who gave birth to that Allison?
Yeah.
And so she had a child before she married the Fredham.
Yeah.
And his name? No, I know, but I mean the child. What was his first name again, who became the pastor? His son's name was Dennis.
Yeah.
Because he was a chaplain in the Air Force.
I've got it in the desk.
We'll look that up, but that was Allison. And then
you
didn't really find out about him or who he was until just a few years ago, right?
No, I heard it on the news one night.
And then he connected with you guys up here, right?
Yeah, I think that's right.
And then we met him in Las Vegas, and he was out visiting his son.
Well, I met him here before. I met him in Las Vegas. He had to come up here, and we got together.
But we have pictures of him and his wife and his son, Dennis, and then they have another son, I think, in Bismarck. So tilt that up a little more, and we'll just get this last, next to Clara, then, who is it? That's your grandpa, or Emma, next to your, Emma is your grandpa, right? Munz?
Yeah.
Munz. And then on the,
Ida.
And that was Ida Strand.
Yeah, no children.
No children. We used to say they lived on the Strand place, and that was half a mile west of South Trinity.
Yeah.
And her husband's name was
Rungvold
Strand. And that's where Marvin Sandvik lived until he moved down to Grand Forks with his daughter. Okay. Well, that's good. Let me just zoom in on the picture again. Yeah, do you have any, remember any stories about your grandpa, Munz?
Well, I'd go over and stay there once in a while. And I used to go to stay there, and for Clara, I'd go to Norwegian school for her. And then went, you know, before regular school, you know, ABCs they called it, but it was in Norwegian. So I got to learn to read Norwegian.
Did you learn Norwegian before you learned English?
that's all I talked before I learned English.
So where did you learn English?
Well, I guess we just picked up later. It's, and of course, when starting school, of course, we grew it some then. It was mostly Norwegian.
Was your grandpa, do you remember him? Was he kind of a happy guy or stern?
I don't know really that much about him.
We're talking with Millard Hovey again. Your grandma's name was Mrs. Munts Munson, right?
Right.
We were just looking at her in that picture, and one of the things that had been, I think, in your dad's desk was this newspaper from, it's dated February 1, 1939, and I'm going to read the story. It's got, well, we're going to look at the headline here. Grafton News and Times, and on the front page there's a story about Mrs. Munts Munson, funeral set for Saturday at South Trinity Church. And we'll just read it here. Funeral services for Mrs. Munts Munson will be held Saturday at 1:30 p.m. at the family home in Fertile Township and 2 o'clock at the South Trinity Lutheran Church. Reverend L.O. Hellacliffe, assisted by Reverend A.A. Helsom, will officiate. Interment will be in the church cemetery. Pallbearers selected are all neighbors, men whom Mrs. Munson had known from their birth or early boyhood, and they are Tobias Helland or Holland, Henry Sander, Henry Lee, Eric Lee, Albert Vigor, and Albert Mittgarten. She was born in Norway December 19, 1858, and when she was 15 years old, came to Osage, Iowa in 1873, where she remained until 1880, when the call for greater opportunities urged her westward and into Dakota Territory. And in March of that year, she filed on a homestead in Fertile Township, the land upon which she lived continuously until she died Tuesday morning. In the fall of 1880, she married Munts Munson, who died in October 1921. At that time, the railroad ended at Crookston, Minnesota, and the journey into Dakota Territory was continued by wagon and horses. She was unusually industrious and resourceful and soon conquered the frontier difficulties of the prairies and helped her husband acquire a large tract of excellent farming land. She was a charter member of the South Trinity Church and always active in its activities. Until the last few weeks, she was active, and then we have a hard time reading the line where the fold has been. Surviving our 6 sons, Martin, Alfred, Oscar, and Gustav of Grafton, Olaus of Adams, and Edward of Park River, and 4 daughters, Mrs. R.G. Strand, Mrs. Albert Hovey and Mrs. Otto Hovey of Grafton, and Mrs. Jewel Fredham of Decorah, Iowa. All the children were home at the time, or when she died Tuesday morning, after an illness of 3 weeks. There are 30 grandchildren, and here's one of the grandchildren, Millard Hovey. Do you remember what she died from?
Well, I think she had cancer in her legs and stuff. Just an old age, you know.
And so if she was
pretty thick of glass.
If she was born in 1858 and then died in 1939, she was 79. Let's see. 42 plus 39 is 79. No, it's 81.
81, yeah.
So that was a pretty good age.
She wasn't too big a woman, she was pretty small.
She must have been pretty tough, though.
Oh, yeah.
If she homesteaded and.
I think Munson, I think he died as early as. I don't know if he even reached 70. Because I remember that time.
You remember Munson dying, your grandpa?
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what he died from?
A heart attack, I think. You know.
And you said he was in his early 70s, probably?
Yeah, I think so.
And then it was Munson who changed the name. His original name had been Hug Hug.
Yeah,
and why did he change it?
Well, there were so many Hug Hugs around here at the time, they were getting mail mixed up and everything, you know.
So Munson was a less common name at that time. Okay. We'll find some more things to document here. In this picture that we're looking at right here, the little lady in the front of the picture is Mrs. Munson. We believe her first name was Ronaug, R-O-N-A-U-G, Ronaug Munson. Ronald Munson. But if she's buried up at South Trinity, we could go up there and see what it's on the gravestone, too. So that's her in the middle on this picture, and then I'm going to turn it over and we'll see some of the names that are recorded there. So we see left to right, Oscar Munson, Alfred Munson, unknown, Annie Munson. Who was Annie, Dad?
She was Marston.
But who was she married to then?
Alfred.
She was married to Alfred, and then Martin Munson, Ida Strand, next to Martin. The other person is unknown, and then Grandma Munson, Mrs. Munson, Munz Munson, R.G. Strand, Ida's husband, and then we're not sure who the woman on the end is.
No, what does it say on that? On that, that other deal you had at the lawyer there? That's the deal, give her first name?
That's what was spelled R-O-N-A-U-G. That, what Dad's referring to is a letter from the attorney to the heirs after her estate had been settled. We're going to look at another picture here that is believed to be the father of Munson. The thought is that his name is Munson Olson Wasandy, and we're not sure exactly how to pronounce that, but Munz spelled M-O-N-S, Olson O-L-S-E-N, and then the last name spelled W-A-S-E-N-D-E-I-E, and again, we're not positive about this, but we think this is to be Munz Olson Wasandy, believed to be the father of Anders and Munz Munson. If indeed it is, this would be a picture of Millard Hovey's great grandfather.
Didn't know.
And the picture we're looking at is a photocopy. Now, another picture we're going to look at is a picture of Anders Munson Hohaug, born on May 30th, 1842, and died in January of 1943, so he's 101 years old. And this was a brother of Muns Munson, so, and again, Muns being Millard Hovey's grandfather.
I think he was down on Detroit Lakes or something. He lived there.
You were saying what? You think he lived in the Detroit Lakes area?
Yeah.
Does it say in that book, Debbie, about was he listed as a charter member at South Trinity?
Who?
Or I thought there was some name you saw in there about one of these people.
Anders Munson Hohaug.
And what does it say?
First Cemetery Committee.
He was on the First Cemetery Committee at South Trinity in this book about the South Trinity congregation. So obviously he was in this area and then probably moved to the Detroit Lakes area.
It could have been he was down around where the Blagan place is, or where Mendes Munson lives in Woody and Butch, west of the bridge there.
Okay, up on... That'd be straight north of the farm I grew up on, up by the Park River, south branch of the Park River. Okay.
There was some of them through there. That's Lillian's dad, permanently.
This is your father here.
Yeah.
Very nice. That's a good picture of you.
Here we're looking at a picture of Gertrude Smerud Hohaug. Gertrude Smerud, S-M-E-R-U-D, Hohaug. And according to this picture, she was the second wife of Anders Munson Hohaug, who we just were videoing. And she was born, according to this, in 1862 and died in 1939. Gertrude Smerud Hohaug. Is that possible? Maybe he married her in the Detroit Lakes area. So if we can't find any more information about her, we might be down in that area that it could be researched. Dad, this vase that Debbie's holding, that was a wedding present to you guys, right? Wasn't that? Or what?
I'm not sure on that, but I think she got it. She went to one of the towns, and they bought. She got a can of cream to sell, and she was supposed to buy herself something. If she bought that vase, I'm not sure at that time, but I think my brother had to put a little more in to get the vase.
I think you're right. It wasn't a wedding gift, but it was bought with cream. And
I think at the same time she bought this picture.
Oh, yeah, the picture that is hanging up here. And Mom had called me about that picture and was wondering if there was any value to it. And I looked up on the internet, and it was... There really isn't much value. It's worth about $60, but a lot of people in America had this picture in their home, and so there's a demand for it because people remember it and they want it back now. Some of the kids remember it, and I forget who did it, but we're kind of zooming in there to find out. It's called Duet by M. Ditleff. Antonio Ditleff, but this is just a copy, of course. And that, so they bought the picture and the vase. And then what about that picture there, or this lamp that's sitting on the table next to you? What do you remember about that?
Not really that much. My folks had the lamp for years, I guess when we moved over on the other place there, that they sent the lamp with us or something. don't know if somebody else got something else at the time. It could have been when they moved into town too, I'm not sure.
Yeah. Okay, but I know it originally was a gas lamp and then...
Kerosene lamp, yeah.
Kerosene lamp, and then somebody had to turn it...
Yeah, my dad had it fixed into electric, you see.
And so the value probably is gone.
The value is gone. Yes.
Because of that, but obviously it's still a...
Still would sell it for quite a bit.
Okay. Here we are looking at Shasta. Hi, Shasta. Gary's dog. It's July 26th, 2002. And Shasta's staying cool, or trying to stay cool. And Debbie and I are picking raspberries. How's the picking, Debbie?
The bushes are just loaded. They're beautiful.
The berries are gorgeous and lots of picking. Show the bowl to the camera. Look at those berries.
Beautiful.
Just pan around Gary's garden here. It's Judy's birthday today, and so Gary and Judy went in to have a little lunch. Yeah, Judy's 61 years old today. Shasta, what's happening? Shasta. Shasta's about 11 years old. Hi guys, what's happening?
Coco and Sadie.
Coco and Sadie. Hi, what's happening, huh? Go up by the cage, Debbie. Hey guys, what's happening? Can you speak? Can you speak? Huh? Can you speak? Yeah. Can you get near water, huh?
Oh, don't look up there.
Bye, dogs.
Bye.
My name is Alberto Luis Andres, but everyone calls me Mary. I'm 21 years old. When I was 8, I walked around in a skirt to wear dress and I got hit. Just to emphasize how tricky all this chemical bodybuilding can get, there's a peculiar intersexual genetic defect called 5-alpha-mutantes that seems to be clustered by heredity in several small villages in the Dominican Republic.
5-alpha-mutantes is the disorder where individuals can undergo tests.
9 years old. That's why I began to feel like a man.
All right, here we are. It is Sunday, July 28th, 2002. And this morning we had church service at Zion for the Orson family reunion. And we've just had supper. It's about 5 to 7. And I'm going to do a little more taping here. Dad, yesterday or the day before, you were telling us about how you ordered Mom's engagement ring. How did you get her ring, and how much did it cost you?
Well, I ordered it through the mail, Montgomery Ward. I think it was somewhere over $13. It takes about 3 days from here to Minneapolis and back again.
Well, not now, but then it did, didn't it?
At that time. Now it maybe takes 4 or 5 days.
So what year would that have been?
I suppose it could have been in 37, maybe.
1937. So did she know she was getting a ring?
I don't know. I don't think so.
Do you remember what she... Was she excited? What did she say when you gave it to her? Obviously she said yes.
I suppose she did, yeah. I think it was at our place at home there. They were picking potatoes at the time.
Had you said that her friend knew before she did?
Yeah.
And who was that?
Mabel Lumsden.
Okay, and that was one of Mom's girlfriends?
I showed it to her first. You guys didn't know it.
And so Mabel didn't think you were giving it to her, did you? Did she?
I don't think so.
So then you got married. You were married, I think we've got some of this on other tapes, but you were married at the parsonage, weren't you?
Right, yeah.
And then this would have been 1938 now, right?
Right.
When you got married.
Yeah.
What was your wedding date?
October 22nd.
1938. And you went on a honeymoon. How much money did you have?
$127.
To your name?
Yeah.
And where did you go?
Well, first night we went to Fargo, and then we, from Fargo, the next day we went to Minneapolis, and all this was, there was a few snowbanks about 3 feet high on the side of the road that, well, a couple of days later, out of Fargo to Minneapolis, 4 ways there, you know.
Yeah.
We'd had a little bit of a snow, and from Minneapolis we stayed a day and a half. We got to Minneapolis, up to her sister. She lives on Franklin Street in Minneapolis. We stopped out by the apartment there, went inside, about an hour and a half, we're going out to get our suitcases. We come out there, they were gone.
What happened?
Somebody stole it.
Uh-uh.
And there we didn't have no clothes outside of what we had on ourselves. But the suitcases were gone. Her wedding dress was in there.
So what happened?
We didn't know right away. We called the cops, and the next morning then they did find them in an alley about a block away. And all that was gone was some trinkets or toothpaste and toothbrushes and stuff like that.
So you had most of your clothes then?
Yeah. But we did go down to a penny store, and I had one in a shirt. You know, when I got to the penny store, as a clerk from, used to be in Grafton here at that penny store.
Oh. So,
After I got her clothes, from there we went to Iowa, Decorah, Iowa, or Ridgeway, to my aunts and cousins who were visited there for about a week.
So now, changing topic just a little bit, you got a call recently while, I think it was last Sunday afternoon, from somebody at Cresco, Iowa, who was married to the Hovey family. And he was doing some research. And what did you learn about your uncle or your grandpa's brothers?
Well, that my grandpa had come from Norway, but he had four other brothers in Norway. They were all named Ole.
Four brothers named Ole.
Oh, yeah. And they also come over here, but I remember the one had come up to visit once, but the rest of them I didn't know.
And so one of the Ole Hoveys then came to visit up here.
Yeah, at one time, yeah.
And you said you were pretty young when
that
happened.
And that would be your grandpa Newt.
Yeah.
And he was the one who smoked the pipe?
Yeah.
And said you said he went like a train, right?
Yeah.
And I think we've got this on another tape, but didn't you sleep with him? When you were a little boy?
Yeah.
And what did he do in the middle of the night?
He'd puff in his pipe. He didn't have a pipe, but he still puffed on it.
What do you mean he was puffing?
He'd blow out, he'd blow the smoke out of it.
While he was sleeping.
Yeah.
Okay. We're gonna stop for a second here, and I think I've got some pictures I want to get on the tape from your wedding, but I have to double check, so we're going to stop. Here we're looking at the engagement ring that Dad ordered from Montgomery Ward and spent $13 on. But it's gold, it's got a diamond, and we're going to get a couple different angles of it here. And this is a picture of Gladys's engagement ring given by Millard. Modeled by Debbie Hovey. Why don't you turn your hand a little bit, just a couple different directions. All right. Here Dad is looking at his family picture, and why don't you point the people out and tell us who they are?
You want me to start from the side here?
Yeah, tilt it up a little bit more if you can. Yeah, that's perfect.
Like that's Arnie.
Your brother Arnie.
Yeah. And this is the top row.
Yep.
It's my dad.
His name was Albert.
My mother Magna.
And that was Magna Munson.
Yeah. And that's me.
Okay.
And we're starting and ending again there. And that would be, it would have to be Elaine, the first one.
Elaine, it lives in Omaha, Nebraska right now. Next to Elaine is
Rody.
Rody.
And then it's Alice sitting next to her mother there. And then it's Marilyn.
Okay. Do you remember when that was taken?
No, I don't.
Okay. We're going to get it from you now and then just take a picture of the picture a little bit. Debbie, if you can just hold it, tilt it more towards me. That's good there. And here we're looking at a copy of the wedding invitation for Magna Regina Munson to Albert Alfred Hovey, spelled with a Y, and announcing their wedding on December 18th, 1912, at 2:00 in the afternoon at their home in Fertile Township, Walsh County, North Dakota. And next, we're going to see a their wedding picture. And this is a picture of Albert and Magna on their wedding day in 1900. Well, maybe not on their wedding day, but it might have been in 1912. And this is a picture of Albert and Magna on their 50th wedding anniversary. This is a picture of Magna Munson, who became Magna Hovey, we're just looking at, on her confirmation day. This was her confirmation picture. Tilted a little, back again, we're getting some glare. That's good. This is a picture of Magna and Albert, probably on their 50th again, in their home in Grafton, North Dakota, and they obviously have gotten a lot of flowers and well-wishers. Here's a picture of Grandpa and Grandma Hovey in their kitchen in Grafton, and she's holding a special coffee pot. It looks like it has some special painting on it. Looks like maybe their names are on it. I'll zoom in and see if we can pick that up. No. Do you remember anything about that coffee pot, Dad? Show him the picture, Debbie.
I think somebody must have painted a rose mold or something on at the Dorchel plane. I can't remember.
Okay, why don't you, hold up that one. We're going to video this picture with, I think it appears that it was taken at the 50th wedding anniversary for Albert and Magna, and Albert is pictured with his sisters, and Dad's going to name the sisters in a minute, but I want to just get more of it on video here, and I'll be quiet. Okay, Debbie, if you can bring it over to Dad. Now you can just look at it and maybe going from left to right.
Left to right. Okay, standing was Emma, which was Mrs. Andrew Allman. And the next one is Nora Rice, married to Cole Rice.
And where did they live?
At Edmore.
Edmore, North Dakota.
Yeah, and then it's Gloria.
Gloria Hovey Allman.
Yeah, married to Oscar Allman, that'd be Donnie and Kenny's mother.
Okay.
That's my dad. And that's the next one is Clara. And that would be Morris and Glenn Munson's mother. And the last one is Ida Erickson. Now they lived at Edmore and they had four children.
Okay. And so, were there others? Did he have other brothers or sisters?
Well, Otto and Pete, but they were passed away at that time.
And where did they live?
Well, Pete was, he lived around Grafton. You see, he was killed in a train accident here. And Otto lived,
And so it was Otto and then Pete.
Yeah.
And didn't Albert go by Pete some too, or that was your brother Arnie?
That was my brother Arnie, yeah.
So Albert was the three boys. And then the sisters, were there other any other sisters, five sisters here?
No, I think it's, you know, I think when that one called from Chris Gordon, one of the, I think I forgot I died that day, I couldn't think. Yes, there was one more sister in Iowa, married to Henry Fretham.
And what was her
name? She's the oldest one, Bertha.
Bertha?
Yeah.
Okay. So Bertha Hovey Fretham.
Yeah. She would have been a mother to, like, George Allison's wife, Clarice. So.
Okay.
Of this.
All right, we're looking at another picture. Kind of a strange-looking couple. And who did you say is in this couple, Dad?
My dad, Garrett Hovey Hardman.
And which one is your dad? The one...
And they with the underwear on, I think.
Okay, and Garrett is the one with the hat on?
With the dress on.
Yeah, why don't you show it to Dad, please?
Yeah.
And so what's going on in this picture?
Well, they're sitting on a bench out by the house there. And he's kind of holding a bouquet of little flowers, you know. And he's got hobnail shoes on. My dad is barefooted, of course. And he's got a short pants on to wear. He's got flowers, holding flowers there.
So what were they doing? Well, you said that was hobo days?
Well, no, I just dressed up for goofing off, I guess.
And so they were kind of having a lot of fun in that time, huh? Yeah. It made your own fun.
Oh, yeah, you had to do that.
Say, speaking of fun, you've told a story that I don't think we've ever gotten on tape over the years here. There was a car that had stalled somewhere or something, and it was a crank-up car, and somebody had to get out and crank it, and... I think she was kind of scantily clad at the time.
Yeah, I don't know if I want to tell that.
Well, we won't show it to anybody.
This was, I took my mother down to visit a neighbor that was with Mrs. Burke. She lived down west of Rhodey's there, before Rhodey lived, you know, by the river there. And that was between that swimming hole we drove by and Davis up in through there.
North of Mant?
Yeah, north of Mant. And I drove the car down there. And here comes the Larson boys.
Which Larsons would that be?
It was Jimmy and Paul. And they come, they've been down there and they decided to go for a ride. And they jumped in the... that Ford they had, you know, no, there was no top or anything but sides, but they didn't put no, they come, you know, out of the swimming hole, you know, new dumped in there. And they stopped for the house and it stopped there. So they wanted me to crank the car. So I wasn't cranking the car. Paul had to get out at last to crank the car. In front of the ladies, sitting in the house.
And he was buck naked, huh?
Yeah.
I thought it was a woman who was naked.
No.
Oh, it was, but it was in front of the women.
Except two girls. Yeah, the woman was with them.
So they'd been swimming north of Mand,
and
then had some car trouble. So your mother saw this then? And
Lisa Burke, her and my mother, Lisa Burke. But they wanted me to crank the car. They were stopped, and then the car stopped, you know.
So why didn't you help them?
No, I wanted to get out. They were dumb enough to drive that way. They couldn't get it going.
That's good.
I'm going to hold that up.
Grandpa Hovey, Albert, was in a... accident, and I'll have Dad talk about this in a little bit, but it was in the Grafton paper at the time. It says, Grafton farmer injured when truck hits tractor. And what it says here is a Grafton area farmer was severely injured Friday afternoon when the truck shown above crashed into a tractor pulling a swather on a township road 7 miles west and a mile and a half south of Grafton. And Debbie, let's hold up those other pictures. You just hold them there, and then I'll keep reading. Hospitalized at the Deaconess, which is the hospital in the city, is Albert Hovey, 67, who was driving the tractor. The extent of his injuries had not been fully determined on Saturday. And we're going to zoom in a little bit here. Obviously, a very serious accident. And it's amazing, looking at these pictures, that he even lived. What do you remember about that, Dad? What happened?
It was a quiet day, and he was driving the swatter down the road, and there was all dust. You know, dust just stayed there. And there's a couple of gravel trucks, but the one gravel truck got by the swatter, you see. But the second truck, he covered the dust, and of course he couldn't see the swatter in the road, and he drove over the wheel on the swatter, you know. And it went over the wheel and the swatter swung it around, and it swung the tractor and everything over in the other ditch. And then the truck was on top of the tractor there. My dad was underneath there, you see.
Underneath the truck?
Underneath
kind
the tractor.
Kind of pinned.
Hanging underneath the tractor then.
Oh boy.
See, there was no cab in the tractor.
Let me just read.
But see, it knocked the tractor away from the swatter. The swatter broke, you see. So the swatter was on one side of the road then. When it cleared, the dust cleared, you know, and they were in another ditch. He broke his heel and arms, legs.
Yeah, it says in the paper here, and the paper didn't obviously at the time know. It says the extent of his injuries had not fully been determined Saturday, although it is known he's suffering from a broken arm, possible leg fractures, severe cuts and bruises, and shock. The accident took place when Hovey started south on the highway for his farm with the tractor and combine, although it was swather, wasn't it? Two gravel trucks owned by A.J. Brezina and Sons of Langdon approached from the rear. The first truck passed the tractor and swather, but the second truck crashed into the vehicles. It was believed that the first impact threw Hovey clear just as the truck crashed onto the tractor, coming to a stop on the top of the machine as shown in the above photo. Driver of the truck was Warren Gustafson, 18 years old, of Milton. Hovey was brought immediately to the hospital by Adams Ambulance Service. Investigating the crash were Deputy Sheriff Orville Olson and State Highway Patrolman Duane Bergen. And so was Grandpa, obviously was in the hospital for some time.
Oh, yeah, he was laid up all winter, you know, and all that. Because he had special nurses Pearl took care of him. And
Pearl Iverson?
Yeah, after he got out of the hospital, at home there, and Mrs. Squint Daly, they had different shifts, you know.
Huh. And next here we're going to look at his obituary that was in the paper when he died. And so after the accident, though, he lived another 8 years.
Yeah, he went out back out in the field.
So he went out back out in the field.
We took the geese away from the tractor, but he got a hold of them and they went out, so we didn't stop them anymore. That's what he liked to do. So.
And we won't read the whole obituary, but it was just talking about when the services will be. How did Grandpa die?
I think it was heart to heart failure. I'm pretty sure. So I was in the hospital when he died. But
here it says, Mr. Hovey was born in Fertile Township on September 16th, 1887. He was married December 18th, 1912, to Magna Munson, who survives. They lived on the home farm in Fertile Township until 1949. When they moved to Grafton, Mr. and Mrs. Hovey celebrated their golden wedding anniversary last October 28th at an open house at the South Trinity Lutheran Church, of which they've been active members. Talks about survivors obviously being the children. Also surviving are 23 grandchildren and 5 sisters, listing Mrs. Sievert Erickson and Mrs. Nora Rice of Edmore, Mrs. Clara Munson, Mrs. Andrew Allman, and Mrs. Oscar Allman, all of Grafton. And then it says Mr. Hovey was the director of the Farmers Elevator Company of Grafton for over 25 years, served as the director of the school district number 114 for many years, and was a member of the South Trinity Church Board for several years. His parents, 2 brothers and a sister, preceded him in death. Back to Millard here. You were saying off tape there that when Grandpa had that accident that they had examined him, and what did they discover?
I thought he had had a broken arm once before, but he hadn't told anybody. And he harnessed his horses and drove in the field.
Huh.
And it healed, you know.
And just it healed on its own.
He was scared to tell his folks.
That he'd broken it. So he admitted it then when they found this?
Well, I suppose he did then, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's how they found it.
Wow. This is the obituary that was in the Grafton paper when Grandma Hovey died, Magna Hovey. And it says, funeral services for Magna Hovey, 84. A lifelong resident of the Grafton area, were held yesterday at South Trinity. And I'm just going to scan down. She resided at the Sunset Home since May 11th, 1970. And it gives some of the information here about her parents. And she received her schooling in Fertile Township, where the family lived and farmed. When she was married, and things that we saw in Albert's obituary. And here we're looking at a picture of, we believe, is Muntz Munson, who is Magna's dad. And most likely this picture was at the Munson place, west of Grafton, where she grew up then, and about a mile north of where South Trinity Church stands. And we've talked about Muntz a little bit earlier on the tape, but we have this picture we wanted to include. The obituary says that Grandma Hovey Magna was church organist, and you were saying, how many years did she do that?
I don't know how many years she was a church organist, but I know she had 42 lessons, which, you know, at that time, compared to what they take now, you know, that isn't very many lessons, but they had to learn so much more each time. And she took that from a neighbor east of Hellerud's there, and he was a music teacher. And she'd walk over there and get lessons.
Haven't you said different times that, and I might have this wrong, but your family would gather around the piano and sing and stuff?
I would play, you know. She'd play the piano or chord, you see. My dad would play the violin, and she'd chord the piano, you see. But see, I had the guitar, and then Arnie would have a saxophone, playing the cornet. And Rhody could play the guitar some too, but she hadn't really started yet. And Marilyn was a little younger, but Marilyn was a real good piano player, you know, for a time, until her fingers got bad.
So you had a lot of music talent in the family. Were any of you singers?
dispensing.
But good.
We used to have a choir out there with these.
Yeah, you still sing good at church.
No, I get worse from smoke to work.
Yeah. So speaking of that, how many years did you smoke?
152.
And when did you, do you remember when you quit?
Oh, I don't know. It was about 15.
So probably until you were in your late 60s then?
Yeah, even in my 60s maybe. I just quit.
Did you quit because you retired?
No, I don't know. I had quit once before a little bit, and then I started a little bit, and then the next time I quit. Over a whole year with a carton of cigarettes and a pickup, but I didn't use it.
Speaking of health-related issues, you said recently you were at the doctor and your cholesterol had gone up. What was your cholesterol reading the last time you were there?
141.
And how old are you?
130 before. I'm 88.
And your cholesterol is 141.
Yeah.
And most young people would like to have that. So what do you think your secret is?
Well, I don't know. I eat a lot of peanut butter and peanuts, nuts.
It probably does it.
I don't know.
So what's your favorite thing to eat?
Anything that tastes good. I guess it's just plain food, I guess that's...
Meat and potatoes.
I don't have to eat meat and potatoes either.
But that works. One other thing we want to look at here, we have Grandpa Hovey's death certificate and just some of the information that we want to have on record here includes... we'll just scan this a little bit so we have it on camera. But probably the most important thing we wanted to note on the death certificate is just documenting name Albert Alfred Hovey, born on September 16th, 1887, passed away August 27th, 1963. His father's name was Knut, K-N-U-T-E. Was it, did they say Knut or Newt?
Knut.
Knut. Hovey, and his mother's maiden name was Gunhild, G-U-N-H-I-L-D Findring, F-I-N-D-R-I-N-G, Gunhild Findring. And is that how we're related to Farmer Findring?
Yeah.
So who would Gunhild be to Farmer?
Well, I suppose she would have been Farmer's aunt then, I suppose.
And Farmer's name is Dwayne Findring.
Yeah.
Dwayne and Joe still attend South Trinity Lutheran Church. And so how did Dwayne get the name Farmer?
Just working out for the neighbors in the country. I think it used to be all sons or aunts. I think at that time, they maybe could have been living in town, and then he was then hopping around out in the country. You know, so.
Yeah. But he wasn't really a farmer himself. I mean,
no, not that I really
he didn't
know.
Own a farm.
No.
But anyway, Dwayne Farmer Findring then is related to the Hoveys, being that Albert Hovey's mother's maiden name was Gunhild Findring. And Grandpa died, Albert died of coronary thrombosis massive, I assume basically a heart attack.
Yeah, because I know I was at the hospital and he was going to call. close up.
So did he? Was he? Did he get sick at home on the farm?
No, he was at the hospital.
He was in the hospital.
Yeah, he went in for. He'd had pains all night. You know, they live in town here. My mother said he had pains all night, but he wouldn't admit or he wouldn't say anything. He'd been laying there in bed, you know, and they, instead of calling the ambulance, waited until the morning, then, you know. Then they carried him down on a chair and took him to the hospital.
Huh. Okay. One of the things we're going to look at here, well, I just want to record too, this is kind of an announcement with Knut's death, and it just says, died Knut O. Hovey, born April 14th, 1855, died February 24th, 1931, and that would be Millard's grandpa. And in funeral services, February 27th at 1 o'clock at the home, and at 2 o'clock at South Trinity Lutheran Church, and that's in 1931. Why would they have a service? That doesn't sound as common nowadays. Why would they have a service at the home and then at the church an hour later?
No, they'd maybe take them to the funeral home in Baltimore, and then they'd maybe take the caskets back out to the house and leave them there. To
so the viewing was
the funeral.
So the viewing was kind of at the house then.
And in a way, I don't know. And then they'd take them to the church. Yeah, because.
And so is the service in the home then kind of just for the family?
There was no service in the home.
Okay.
There could have been some visitation.
Yeah, maybe a little prayer or something.
I don't remember too much on that.
Yeah.
But,
well, that was 60, you know, that was 71 years ago, so.
Yeah.
Okay, we're, you had told us, and we want to look at this one document here, about Grandpa Hovey, the farm that you grew up on and that they ended up on wasn't where he was originally? What was the story
no,
with the
no.
Mitt Gardens?
I think he was on a farm farther north there.
Okay.
And Mitt Garden was at a farm farther south there. Well, the ones, yeah, and it was, as they were farming, they would meet each other on the road, and this thought, you know, we're meeting all the time, so the why don't we just exchange places or something? I guess that's what they've done in a way.
Yeah. And I think we have in the files somewhere here some of the documents, the legal documents that made that happen.
You see, I think that tree claim, well, not tree claim, I think that was Knut Hovey. See, I suppose he was farming that one then, and I don't know if Mitt Garden could have had one a little farther south, and then the Knutie moved so he's south, and so he had his together, and where Earl and I own are now, they had that one and that one down where Vance lives now, by the, you know, by where Rody is.
Yeah.
The Albert Mitt Garden place.
Okay. And like I said, we've got some documents on file here that can really trace that. But one of them that I want to zoom in on is particularly interesting. It's fine like that, Debbie, actually. This document, and it won't all show up here, but it's signed by a Mr. Carnes, the way it appears, who's the or a secretary for the recorder of the General Land Office of the United States of America, and it's a document to encourage the growth of timber in the western prairies. And this is in the Mitt Garden name, but then obviously this is part of the land that came into the Hovey family possession, and it is dated the 31st day of December in the year of our Lord, 1889. And Benjamin Harrison was the president at the time. And there's a wax seal on the bottom left-hand corner, and obviously a very interesting document from that time that we need to get a physical copy of as well. But Benjamin Harrison was the president when this was happening. And we're a little out of order with what we were doing earlier, but we just want to photograph here a copy of the marriage license for Albert and Magna. In the basement of Millard's house here in Grafton, unfortunately over the years it didn't last, but we have some fragments of a more decorative piece, a lot of which is in Norwegian. From their wedding, but this appears to be the official marriage license from the state of North Dakota, dated back in 1912. Certificate of marriage, again for Albert and Magna, and the witnesses at the bottom here on the left are Alfred Munson and Nora Hovey. Who is Alfred?
My mother's brother, Alfred Munson.
And then Nora, one of your dad's sisters?
Nora Hovey, yeah.
Okay, so brother and sister of the bride and groom were the witnesses. Okay. So how long have you lived in this house?
I'm not sure, about 15 years ago.
15? It's maybe getting close to 20.
Could be.
So 1303 Hill Avenue, and this is where, what Brecke built it?
Herbert
Brecke built
it. Herbert Nettle.
And one of my teachers, Earl Brecke, that was his parents, and they used to live here. And so we're going to go for a little ride out into the country. Here we are driving through the park in Grafton, Lesticle Park. Some beautiful flowers and what were you saying, Dad, that they do at Christmas time, or they did this Christmas?
Well, all their businesses have advertisement out here. They have displays and decorations. They decorate certain trees. And
we read in the paper this week that the guy who's taken care of the park has done it for 50 years.
Lessico used to have a flour mill here, you know, down years back. He's the one who was here.
Just gonna swing over here because there's some very nice flowers. Some people coming on their bikes. Okay, I can get it. We're coming up on to a part of the Park River, and you've told us over the years there's a swimming hole that you used to come to here.
That's where the swimming hole is.
Okay, we'll take a shot of that when we pull around. see it. And say that again, if we didn't maybe get it on camera. Well, what, you used to come swimming here?
I didn't, but that's where it was. That was the craft before they had the swimming pool built in. There used to be more trees there, and they'd have rope hanging there, a diving board over there.
Little different than swimming pools nowadays.
The river was maybe a little higher at the time. They'd have band concerts down here.
And I used to play tennis here when I was in high school and college. And the state school, Dad, has been here for many years.
Yep.
You said there used to be a little rivalry between Grafton and Park River, and wasn't there a cheer that the Park River kids would do when Grafton and them played?
Well, Grafton's cheer was rooted to toot, rooted to toot. We're the boys from the Institute. So Park River come back, rooted to toot, rooted to toot. The feeble-minded Institute.
And now they've turned a lot of this into apartments, some very nice apartments. We're on the way out into the country. What are we looking at here, Dad?
They're bison, buffalo, called bison.
Who do they belong to?
Olsen Brothers.
And are those the guys that rent from you too?
Yeah.
How long have they been in the buffalo business?
I don't know, 3-4 years now, I think, about that.
Pretty good size herd here.
Oh, and there's babies.
See a little one back there?
Yeah. There's lots of little ones in the middle.
If they have them little ones, I guess the whole herd will gather on and protect them for them. They say.
Yep.
Thank you.
out in the beans.
Yeah. We're just out driving northwest of Grafton, and we come for many rides out this way to see if we can see some deer, and we got a little glimpse of one there. We're about a mile away from where the buffalo are, and we'll see what more we can find. Here we go. I just want to get up a little further.
Flagging.
Oh, there's two. Oh, there's a whole bunch. See them?
Yeah, little ones.
Yeah.
You know, they got twins.
Yeah.
There. Are you getting something?
We are looking east to Grafton. It's just kind of a pretty evening with the sun and the grain. And continuing our little ride and searching for some more deer. Trying to see the slight rainbow over Grafton. And so we're coming to the end of our ride. Those deer that we just filmed kind of surprised us. And one of the beautiful North Dakota sunsets. Pretty clouds. You hear the crickets or so now we have returned from our ride, and the wildlife that we see in the house is on the floor in the kitchen, the hen and the rooster. So it's still light outside, and it's July 29th or 8th, did we say? 28th, and it's 9:25, and Debbie's writing in a book. So, successful road trip here, and I suppose we can go sit down in the TV room and we maybe fill a little more of the tape out before the news comes on. So, away you go, Dad. What do you remember about thrashing, Dad, before they had the modern combines? I mean, how would you do it? I know they had, well, you'd cut the hay into bundles and...
Oh, you had the grain, now you'd have to cut it into bundle with the binder first, then you'd have to shock it, you know, put the, you know, what is it called, shock it up, and then that would cure a little that way, and then you'd have to have a thrashing machine. Well, you had have quite a few men there, and it cost you quite a bit more to handle that than us combining, you know. You had a cook car, and at least we had a cook car. Some would board them in the houses, but of course we thrashed for other people, so we had cook cars for under our own.
I didn't know you thrashed for other people, so.
Well, see, my dad and Otto had a, my dad had a tractor, not a thrashing machine, but yeah, we used to thrash for, well, like Blagans and, you know, Henderwick, and we thrashed one year, we thrashed for Willie Larson, Ordals, Johnny Brecky,
that was in
Sanders.
In addition to doing your own.
Yeah, Sanders. I think we had 35 days in one year.
So what time of the day would you normally start and end?
Well, one fall we had just about every day we're going at 5 o'clock in the morning thrashing.
Till what time at night?
We tried to send the first team home at 7 o'clock at night, so we're done by about a quarter after seven. So we'd unload a load in about 15 minutes.
Wow. Would you have a big meal at the end of the day then, or?
Well, supper, yeah. Well, yeah, a good sized meal, you know. Same way at dinner time, breakfast. Cooks would have to start out about 3 o'clock in the morning, get their meals ready.
So they maybe had an even longer day.
Oh, the cooks had, they're the ones that had long days, plus fixing two big lunches a day.
What would you have for breakfast and lunch?
Well, for breakfast, I usually had, you had your cereals and maybe eggs, maybe sometimes leftover meat and stuff for supper, you know, whatever some people wanted. And that way.
And then, like, at dinner time?
Well, they had meat and potatoes. And I had good meals all the time.
Because you needed the energy.
Yeah. Pie, just whatever.
What kind of pie would they make?
Oh, different kinds.
I mean, would there be blueberries, apple?
I suppose apples and apples and stuff like that. But and a lot, they used a lot of sauce. Mm-hmm. A lot of fruit sauce.
That'd keep you regular.
Apricots.
So what kind of work did you mainly do in that thrashing? What was your job?
Well, almost anything. I wound up at last. One year I spike pitched, or a couple of years I spike pitched. That means you stayed by the machine and helped unload it, every load, you know. But then the second year, then, was two of us spike pitched, so we chained up every other load. Plus the one guy in the rack. Some years, so we had two men to the each rack, and that, and then you didn't need a spike pitcher. But as a rule, we were on five teams, two spike pitchers, three field pitchers. That way.
What were field pitchers?
Helped unload out in the field, you know.
Okay.
They were the guys that were hauling, they helped load.
What was the hardest part about threshing like that?
Well, it'll be the heat. Windy days was tough, you know, real tough. It was dusty a lot of times. Chaff.
And obviously you couldn't shower at night, or?
No, nothing like that. You'd take a wash, but there was nothing rigged up for showers or anything.
Yeah.
That would be for Saturday nights. Yeah. Some people would. Went to town, did shower at the barbershop.
Yeah. I remember you've said over the years, some of the guys would, the hired men would have long underwear on a good chunk of the winter and into the summer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
What do you remember about that?
Well, there was some wouldn't change from the long or whole underwear. Before July, then they'd change. What they call BBDs, you know, shorts. You know, like,
that'd be kind of flavorful, huh?
Yeah.
You raised beets for a while.
3 years.
And that was what, in the late 40s?
48, 49, and 50.
Okay, and that was what, is that when beets were first introduced in this area?
No, they'd been introduced quite a while before, but when we started, it was supposed to be mechanical, you know. Well, we found that out in the area. It wasn't mechanical. What a harvester, and paid $7,500 for it. I think we took up 7 acres with it. And we had to switch over by handing in, top by hand.
Because the harvester just wasn't doing its job?
It wasn't equipped to do the job. But that was the way to go, and they just about told us what to do at that time. But we could have had all the acres we wanted at that time without buying them, you know. So we could had 120 acres we signed up for.
Yeah. And then were you doing beets and potatoes at that time,
yeah,
too?
Yeah.
As well as the small grains?
I'd done most of the beets. Well, we'd do the beets later. We'd try to do potatoes first, but then if it was raining, and then to start out with, well, they figured that if you're white, you know, you couldn't top beets or anything. But we said, well, we offered to I hear the guys would pay you by the hour. We said we'd give you $1.25 an hour if you want to top along with the Mexicans. Mm. They found out they could top just as much as the Mexicans.
Yeah. So, obviously you lived through the Depression and things, and
oh, yeah.
What were some of the lowest wages you ever remember making?
Well, a hired man, as a rule, he got room and board, maybe $18 a month for wages.
And that'd be obviously more than 40 hours a week working, too, probably.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You'd maybe start out at 6 in the morning and go up to 7, 8 at night, you know.
6 days a week, or...?
Well, six, yeah. Yeah. Some of them would have to work Sundays, you know, we'd change off Sundays. So that was one thing we're having Kathy. I agree, we have to be there every day. Whether you had one car or a dozen,
yeah.
It don't matter. But,
So, and hired men would make that $18 a month in room and board. What about you? Were there days you hardly made anything?
Oh, yeah, a lot of days we didn't get paid. No, we didn't get paid. We had a board and room.
So, like, during the Depression, when you were farming, obviously you made it through the Depression, but...
Yeah, that's about all. You didn't have the money to spend. You know.
Yeah.
Well, you just didn't have any money for it.
But you were able to eat because you lived on
the
farm.
Yeah, you had chickens. You had the milk and cream, and, you know, you had your firewood. So we had electric lights put in, and that must have been the early 30s, my dad had electric lights put in. So we had electricity, you know.
And did that come through?
No, we had plant.
No, but I mean, oh, I see. So it wasn't related to the REA at that point.
Delco, plant, batteries in the basement.
Okay. I know we're getting...
The hired girl would get maybe $2 to $3 a week in wages.
Hmm.
That was her wages.
We're getting towards the end of the tape, so I'm just... It could stop at any... We're going to switch topics a little bit. I think you've mentioned on the tape that you were confirmed in Norwegian and
right.
Spoke Norwegian a lot. You've told a story before about a young guy who came from Norway to teach?
Yeah.
How does that go?
Well, he's going to teach a class at one of the schools or the universities, and he was going to teach them, you know, how speed, you know, then he says, we'll take the word fart, he says, you know. He says, what it means is quick, you know, quick like fart, he says. Of course, all the kids started to laugh, you know, and the more they laughed, he couldn't quite figure this out, you know. No, he tried to explain to him what the word meant. You know. He got more trouble.
What? I've got to hold the cameras. Here, there we go. Can you say something in Norwegian now?
Are you doing good? Still good, though? Are you a good boy?
Oh, I'm a very good boy, yeah.
Even that hustru and then, what nigger do you
I don't know.
What does that mean?
That wife of yours, do you like her?
Oh, and he says he doesn't know.
Oh, yes, I love her very much. But I wasn't sure what you were asking before, so. Anything else in Norwegian you can think of?
Well, I talked to her until I started school, about 6 years old, and then I started talking English then.
So you can still understand it, and
well, I understand Norwegian, yeah, but I can't talk it like I used to. You forget, you know, all that.
Do you remember relatives from Norway or people from Norway stopping at the farm and coming by?
Well, oh yeah, but everybody, your neighbors, they were all spoke Norwegian in the old days.
Yeah.
They were outside of the, if the Bohemians come over, you know, that, you know, they kind of converse different, a little bit sign language sometimes. Mm-hmm. Or if, when the Arabian peddlers come around, you know, sell wares, you know, they carry trunks around and come in the buggies. And I know that one, he'd stay there overnight, you know, and in the morning he was going again. But they'd always give you some pencils and stuff like that to stay over, take care of the horse. But then he told my mother, he says, you want to buy a bachelor? And my mother couldn't figure this out. She thought he meant a batch of bread, you know, and he couldn't figure out. He was explaining, just buy a batch of bread, want to buy a batch of bread. And then he was going to show her. He had a bedspread, he wanted to sell her. He wanted to sell a batch of bread. She couldn't catch on to this.
That's good.
Talk more about the peddlers coming. I mean, and you said they were Arabian?
Yeah, Arabians, Assyrians. Yeah, someone carried it on their backs. And yeah, that hope was in them days, you know, gypsies too. But some of them would, I don't remember coming to our place, but some of them, hobos could come around and they're limping and begging for money and all that stuff. Their legs were bad. And then they'd maybe give money. You watch them after a while, everybody got down the road, never going to beat everything. But I can remember the gypsies who would come, and they'd come in wagons again, and they'd stop back in the woods. And we were a little scared when they come around, but of course, you got chickens around, they'd disappear too, you know. Okay. They'd pick them up, but they were great to go and scrounge for even the stuff. They move on to other places. That's the way the gypsy life was, you know.
Yeah.
So these different people were coming by the farm? They just go from farm to farm?
Yeah. Well, like the peddlers. A lot of the peddlers, they were nice people. And, nothing wrong with them.
And you said that your mom and dad would often let them sleep at your place.
Oh, yeah, they stay overnight, yeah. Put the horse in the barn or sleep on in the house.
And they'd feed them then? And
Oh, yeah.
Would they pay for that, or was that
maybe,
just...
Maybe give you a pencil or two or something.
Okay. But, I mean, they were really getting free room and board. And
well, in other words, they were, in a way, you know.
Where would they sleep?
In bed upstairs.
Okay. That wouldn't happen nowadays. People wouldn't be so trusting, so... Okay. Whoops, I'm gonna stop. How old were you when you started working on the farm? I mean, what kind of chores did you have as a real young boy?
We were about 6, 7. We were out in the barn helping along. I plowed when I was 12 years old on a Fordson tractor.
On a Fordson tractor? When you were 12? Okay. And then, when did you and Arnie really start farming together?
About 34, I think, when we bought that bigger place. First year, I think we made less than $50 after we paid our taxes.
Wow.
In one
so
year?
We didn't have no spending money.
Yeah.
Of course, it was in the middle of the Depression, but $50 between the two of you after taxes in one year. Were you living at home at the time?
Yeah, of course. We helped on the farm then, you know, so.
So at least you had a roof over your head and...
You didn't get... If you had any money, they'd maybe give you 25 or 30 cents if you went to town. If you got... And if they had money to go to town with, you know.
Did you talk about, was it a 36 Ford you had?
Yeah.
When did you get that then?
In 36, 90. 36, 35, I think, in the last part of 35, things started to go up a little bit. And We had a team of horses we traded in on it. Well, our dad helped us buy that Ford. That Ford was $800 and some. But it was the best Ford you could get for us.
And how long did you have it?
Till after the... it's way past the end of the war. You couldn't buy a car, you know, after when the war was on.
So you had it for quite a few years.
Oh, yeah. I overhauled it myself. I had drawn all the Nash. You got a house weighed 50,000. I had a 100,000. I took it apart and I sent to Montgomery Ward and the rings. Tore it apart myself and overhauled it and put it back together. Then I drove it to 136,000, I think.
Wow.
And I traded it off.
So we've just got a little tiny bit of time here. You're 88 years old, soon 89. What's the secret?
I don't know. Unless you can breathe, I guess.
All right, so we're going to stop the recording here.
Take deep breaths and stuff.
And keep breathing.